Today that God is good. Amen?
Amen.
And I think we can all agree that we can sing for a long time about the goodness of God. Let's bow our heads together, and as we pray, I'm just going to give you a chance to pray and to seek the Lord, just maybe to thank Him for His faithfulness in your life. Thank Him for His goodness towards you, that all of your life that He has proven Himself faithful. So would you just take a few moments here as we enter into this time of worship, inviting the presence of God to fill this place. Thank Him. Give Him praise. Give Him worship. Even now. We don't have to think very long or very hard to come up with many, many reasons why you've been so good, why we are so blessed by your presence, by your mercy, by your grace, by you have shown your forgiveness. Even when we have rebelled against you, you have restored us into fellowship with you. You have removed the stains and shame and guilt of our sins, and you have clothed us with your garments of righteousness. It is through Christ Jesus our Lord that we come to you, that we can have a relationship with you, that we can enjoy the benefits and the blessings of this new life that you have given to us. God, you have been so faithful. You have been so good. You have been with us through the fire. You've been with us through the flood. You've been with us even in the valley of the shadow of death. You have overcome the grave. And God, we are just so grateful for who you are and all that you have done for us. And Lord, let us never fail to give you thanks. Never fail to give you praise. For you are so worthy. God, you invite us in. You answer our prayer. You hear us when we cry out to you from the depths of our souls. Lord, we thank you that you are all powerful. We thank you that you are all wise. We thank you that you are sovereign over all things. There is not a moment that you're not in firm control of all that is happening throughout this universe, let alone within our own individual lives. God, this morning I thank you that as the church gathers in the name of Jesus, we gather together with humility, with reverence, and that we gather with expectation that we will hear from heaven. So Lord, help us then to respond in faithfulness and obedience. We praise you. Well, again, we are grateful that you are here this morning. Some of you survived the harvest test, I see, which is always a good thing, and good to tell about it the next day. Hey, let me just say a word of appreciation to everybody who brought in water bottles or coolers or donated toward that cause or helped in any way. We were blessed yesterday with the opportunity to give out over 500 bottles of water to sweat-drenched band kids and football players coming off the parade floats and others that walked along the route. And it was a real needed ministry. And so we, in the name of Jesus, were able to minister the love of Christ to over 500 people yesterday. And so we're thankful for those who participated in any way. So we appreciate that.
Take the coolers up in the back.
Yeah. If you brought a cooler to help out, they are all sitting right out here in the back. Make sure you get it to if you want it, or if not, we'll donate it to the next person that needs to go. So that's how that works. that you need to know about coming up today is the Heartland Baptist Network Picnic. We had a good church picnic last Sunday out at Sion, but if you're not all picnicked out yet, you have another opportunity today. Now, this one is with our sister churches throughout the Heartland Baptist Network, so we get to meet some new people. We get to connect with some of our friends from other churches in the Springfield area that maybe we don't get to see that often. So I always enjoy these kind of things. I love spending time with other pastors and getting to know some of their people as well. So that's what this day's picnic is all about. It's going to be held at Western Oaks Baptist Church in Springfield at 5 o'clock. You're welcome to go there on your own, but I will say this as well. If you would like to ride together, I will be at the church and leaving from the church here at 4:30. And if you want to ride with me, I'd love to take you along. So, yes, Andrew. Okay. Now, the menu is walking tacos. I'm not real sure what a walking taco. I know what a regular taco is. I'm not sure if these tacos have legs or how that works exactly. But anyway, that's what they're serving. They're serving drinks along with that. So it's not like a huge meal. If you want to bring something else to eat in addition to that, that's up to you. But that's what they're serving. All right? So there'll be a lot of games to play as well, bounce houses for the kids, and different activities like that as well. So that's what that is. We invite you and encourage you to come out this afternoon. All right, Andy.
Yesterday, we handed out flyers to any of the Florida High School junior high kids that we saw who came in. And so the youth group will still be meeting here at 6 o'clock. Actually, your thing's at 5. Do you guys want to make a comment?
I'm good for it.
You can read the other announcements in your bulletin and also pay attention to your newsletter for other communications, things that are happening and going on. And again, welcome. Hey, I'm grateful to have my mom and dad here with us today, Gary and Loretta, all the way from Robinson, with their friends Mike and Marilyn, and I'm grateful for them being here as well. And see Ray and Sarah and Remington joining us as well from even farther Southern Illinois than Robinson is. So. Any other guests with us today? Did you bring anybody that you want to introduce to the church today? I think most of us are otherwise familiar. Good to see Bonnie and Dave getting back on the track. All right, so in case you're wondering, why is everybody wearing t-shirts today? We don't always wear t-shirts, but we don't always wear ties either. But we are promoting the Mission Illinois Week of Prayer and Offering. One of our partnerships as a church here is with our IBSA churches, Illinois Baptist State Association, comprising 900 plus churches, Southern Baptist churches, throughout the state. We are grateful to be a part of that. And so many of us have been connected in one way or multiple ways with some of the events and activities of the IBSA. And we are encouraging you to not only pray for the work of Illinois Baptist Missions, but also to consider giving. We are receiving a special offering, and many of you received offering envelopes like this in your bulletin last week. There are some more of these on the tables near the offering boxes as well. And we encourage you to prayerfully consider how you might give so that that work can continue and flourish right here in our state. 100% of what you put in this envelope will go to missions work in Illinois. So with that said, I would love to hear a few of you who are wearing IBSA t-shirts to tell us what event you've been involved with and how that has impacted your life in one way or another. So who would like to start?
Well, I'm
You guys knew this was coming, right? Come on, now.
Thank you.
All right.
So we have on our priority shirts from last week, or last year, not last week. It all runs together when we start doing and priority is just a wonderful opportunity for the ladies to get together, and there's always just wonderful teaching and music, and it's always just a really uplifting weekend. No matter what age group, we've had some of our teens there, and this last year we did it
here.
So we did it here, and it was really cool. We got to know some of the folks that, you know, when you're up here and facing this way, you don't always see back here. And so it was really cool to get to meet some folks who are members of our church that we don't normally get to talk to, and just the fellowship and everything was just a wonderful time. We don't know whether it's going to be in person or here at the church again next. Well, I said in person. That's in person too, and we're in person too. It'll be in person. We don't know whether it'll be here or in Springfield, but it'll be coming up in April of this next year. So
they've already got it online where you can sign up. Either way. So if any of you that attended last year are interested, do the so I have an idea whether you would rather meet here and do it like we did last year, or whether you would like to have faith that we can go to the downtown hotel and meet as a big group. I mean, I've been to Priority and Angie has for many, many years, and it's always fun, what, day and a half or whatever, but it was fun this time.
Well, we have 10 ladies. And would you be happy to do it again?
All right, very good. Thank you. All right, Ron.
Well, I can remember the first time I showed up for one of vision trips. I was scared. I'd never done anything like this. And I really show up. That's the thing. That's when you get your blessing. Because once you show up and get involved, God leads you the rest of the way, and He will bless you. The best one I can remember, I don't know exactly where we went, but we went to a church. We painted the parsonage and cleaned gutters, and of course it involved in a little board fight. but we met so many good people. Did all the mission trips we made. Just good to be around people that love the Lord. And it's really a blessing. So if you're not involved, please get involved.
And specifically, your t-shirt is talking about a children's mission day, which is kind of a cool thing, too, because we've been able to bring encourage children and entire families to be a part of that.
That's where I relate with the best.
And it doesn't surprise us that there's water fights involved anytime I was. Good. Somebody else with a t-shirt that wants to tell about why you're wearing that today. All right. Was that the same year that Ron splattered that tar all over the parking lot there?
I think it must have been. I know the men were off trying to accomplish something with tar.
The tar was way too old.
Yeah, it was. Good. What are two others of you sure about the t-shirt that you're wearing today? All right, yes.
I have on Mission Spectacular as well. I don't remember where this was from. It says 2012, but that was a long time ago, so I don't remember what one it was, but the one Mission Spectacular that really comes to mind, I went with the youth group, and we had been assigned a place to go, but when we got there, I don't remember if someone else had already
they've been doing youth encounter for a long, long time.
Yeah.
I remember back in the day before I was ever a pastor, taking kids from our church in Rockford down to Springfield, you know, for a youth encounter. That was quite a big deal in the Pacific. What they call now the Prairie Capital Convention Center.
Yeah.
I went to youth encounter when I was young.
Who all has ever been to youth encounter?
Well, I've been to a lot of youth encounters too back in the day, not as a youth, but as a leader. But the shirt that I happened to be wearing was from my trip to, one of my trips to Uptown Baptist Church with the Baptist women. We also went to the Christian Activity Center in East St. Louis as Baptist women. And we've been to all kinds of youth encounters and things like that with the youth through the year of mission trips, and it's been a blessing to get to know a lot of Christian women all over the state, and I've had some precious friends from that.
Amen.
All right, one more. If anybody else wants to show off your shirt. Nora, I did see your shirt when you came in. Where are you at? Greg, is she up there? Is she hiding?
She's hiding. Okay.
Hey, can you just stand up and show us your shirt? We won't ask you to talk about it. All right, everybody can see Nora up there. She is wearing her shirt from Kids Camp this past summer that she went to, along with several others from the church up at Streeter Baptist Camp. So you'll have to ask her about it, you know, without her having to get up in front of everybody and talk. Well, speaking of Streeter, I am wearing my Streeter Baptist Camp shirt, and I tell you what, that is one of my favorite places on the planet, Streeter Baptist Camp. And if you've ever been there, many of you have, you know what I'm talking about. And I love the work that they've done up there, the ministries that they have going on, everything from kids camp to pastor retreats. And took a motorcycle trip up there everything's always a couple years ago, but it was probably 7 or 8 years ago. Anyway, all these things that we're talking about today just helps us to understand a little bit better about the connections that we have with the work and the ministry going on in Springfield with the Illinois Baptist State Association, which is, again, it's a network association of churches. And the friendships that we make, as Bonnie had alluded to, the opportunities, the mission trips that they help plan for us with the children and families and other opportunities just make it a great way for us to stay connected, to stay involved, to know that we have resources available. Let me just give you a couple of examples. When I was planning, preparing for this Rio mission trip over the summer, one of the ones I stayed in contact pretty heavily throughout that planning process was Brad Lovett, who is one of the guys at IBSA. He met with us on a couple of occasions and really helped think through some of the logistics of scheduling and traveling and everything we need to know to be ready for that. So I was very grateful to have somebody I could pick up the phone and say, hey, I don't know how to do this. What do I need to do about that? And he was always so helpful to answer those questions and to meet there. Many of you know, see, we talk about events, we talk about resources, but you know, when we think about the kind of connections that we have with IBSA, my first thought is not just about the stuff that they have, but the people that they have working for them. So many of you have made such great connections. Almost everybody in here knows Mark Emerson, right? He is with IBSA. He served as the interim pastor here at Petersburg before I came on board and helped navigate the church through some stuff in the interim period there. I'm grateful for Mark and his ministry. I'm thankful for Scott Foshi. He has preached here before when I've been absent. And, you know, Scott and I, we stay in touch. We communicate fairly regularly. And Scott texts me, not every Sunday morning, but often Sunday mornings, he'll send me a text and says just something about, hey, I'm praying for your brother and thankful for your willingness to, you know, be a minister of the gospel there in Petersburg. And just, you know, ways that the IBSA personnel stay in touch with us and in contact. Many of you have been encouraged by others that you could name through IBSA as well. And I think it's just a great way for us to partner together, knowing that what we're doing is just a little bit of what it looks like when churches get together and do things together that we cannot do on our own. But God blesses that. He blesses it abundantly. So, again, all that to say, appreciate your support, your prayers, your encouragement, and your willingness for us to work together with the folks at IBSA. I might even share another story or two a little bit later on about a couple of connections that I think are pretty important as well. But let's take a moment to pray together for the work of IBSA, shall we? Father, we thank you that we are able to partner with these other churches and with those you have raised up to help lead and facilitate and provide encouragement and equipping and support through this network. And I thank you that we can partner together to accomplish more, to do more, to experience more than we can by ourselves. So Lord, thank you for that spirit of cooperation and the good work that's being done. Thank you for Nate Adams and his leadership and all those who serve the churches throughout this state. And Lord, I pray that you would encourage us to consider how we might be more faithful in giving and continuing to pray for that work and the ministry that's happening, so that our neighbors here in central Illinois and indeed throughout this entire state, from Chicago to Cairo and every place in between, might hear the gospel, be challenged to follow you more faithfully, and that many would come to Christ. We pray for the churches, not only to gain in health and strength, but we pray that more churches might be planted and established throughout this state. Lord, we pray for the campus ministries throughout the state as well, and that you would continue to raise up leaders to reach the college campuses with the message of the gospel. Father, for every pastor and every pulpit throughout the state today, I pray that the message would go forth clearly and boldly, and that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and that there is no other way to the Father except through him. Lord, may that gospel message ring loudly throughout this state so that you would be glorified as people turn to you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Would you stand together as we read scripture and then follow that with the wonderful grace of Jesus in song? And this will just be an all-read kind of a thing, so Pam, if you would just help us hit that as we go. This is down to Psalm chapter 147, the first six verses.
Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God, for it is pleasant, and a song of praise to sing. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars. He gives to all of them their names. Great is our Lord, and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. The Lord lifts up the humble. He casts the wicked to the ground.
Scott, would you come, please?
I do want to clarify something I said this morning when I was coming up here to sing. I was a joke. I was
Matthew's Gospel in chapter 8, as we continue studying through what Matthew has to say, presenting Jesus as the King to whom we should bow before in full submission and obedience. And Matthew also has a lot to say about what it means to live a life following after Jesus. So we're going to look at both of those things here today. As you're turning there, let me also mention just a couple of things. Let me encourage you to pray for our farmers, as many of them are starting out in the fields and doing great work of harvesting. How many of you like to eat? Anybody like to eat here? Well, let's thank our farmers for giving us an opportunity to have food on the table. I want to ask all of our farmers and farm families to stand that are here today. We want to recognize you and honor you for the work that you're doing, and we want to pray for you here this morning as well. So go ahead and stand. If you're a farmer or a farm family, still waiting for a couple of you to stand. That's all right. We want to appreciate you and pray for you as well. So stay standing for just a moment, if you will. And I'm going to ask, who am I going to ask? Rick, if you don't mind, just ask a word of blessing upon our farmers for their health, their safety, and God's hand just to be upon them here this season.
Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the individuals who are tasked with the raising of the crops and of the animals that are utilized by the people of this world. We want to thank you for their endeavors and for their hard work and for the things they have to suffer through. With you at their side, the job is easier, but it is still a job. Be with them, lead, guide, and direct them in all that they do. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen. But Matthew chapter 8, as we're going to see today, we are encouraged, and not just encouraged, but instructed to follow Jesus with the kind of faith that is unflinching, even in the midst of the hardship that we know is coming with that, the cost that is involved with that. And we're going to do that because Jesus has proven himself worthy. Let me see, I think I've got my clicker here, Pam. I'm going to get this going. This is the main idea right here. If you want to write that down, you can, or just put that in your heart. This is what we're going off of from our passage today. We can follow Jesus with unflinching faith, no matter what the cost, because he has already proven himself worthy, and he promises that it will all be worth it. Picking this up in verse 14 of Matthew chapter 8, reading through verse 22 today. And when Jesus entered Peter's house, he saw his mother-in-law lying sick with a fever. He touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she rose and began to serve him. That evening they brought to him many who were oppressed by demons, and he cast out the spirits with a word and healed all who were sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. He took our illnesses and bore our diseases. Now, when Jesus saw a crowd around him, he gave orders to go to the other side. And a scribe came up and said to him, "Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." Another of the disciples said to him, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." And Jesus said to him, "Follow me and leave the dead to bury their own dead." So God, would you take this word and give us insight, give us revelation, may your spirit impress upon our hearts the truth that we might serve you well in faith and in obedience. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, well, let's say that Doug Holliday, who is one of our farmers and farm families, let's say that I call Doug up tomorrow. Because I know that they work hard. John, is a kind of slave driver out there, and Doug can probably use an extra little assistance. And so I called Doug up tomorrow and said, "Hey, Doug, I know you guys have got a lot on your plate. It's harvest season, and I'm going to be there for you. I'm going to give myself to serve in whatever capacity you need. I can do whatever you want. I don't have a lot of experience, but I'm willing to help out in any way that I possibly can." So Doug says, that's great, Rob, as he rolls his eyes a little bit and says, You know, farm work is not easy. It's not like that cushy job that you have, you know, where you sit in an air-conditioned office, you know, most of the day. You know, and we start pretty early, but if you want to be here, show up at 5:30 and we'll get started. And I'm like, Doug, that's a great idea, but, you know, I'm kind of used to sleeping in a little bit later than that. Don't get up quite that early, so I'll be there like, you know, maybe 9:30, 10:30-ish, if that's okay. And I said, you know, sometimes that dust out there bothers me a little bit, so, you know, if it gets too much, I might have to just step back in, and it's super hot outside, so, you know, if I need to take a break, you know, every 15 or 20 minutes just to get into some air conditioning, you know, I might have to do that too. And, you know, and then I've got this TV show that I watch at 4:30 every afternoon, so I'm going to have to bail out, you know, maybe a little bit earlier than you guys are used to bailing out, so I hope that's okay too. How committed am I to really helping Doug in the harvest? Not so much, really. But I think a lot of times when we come to Jesus and say that we really want to follow him, say that we want to be there for him, say that we want to serve him, do whatever he asks us to do, our attitude is a little bit like that attitude that I was describing with my willingness to help Doug out. We want to come to Jesus and do it on our terms, when it's easy for us, when it's convenient, when the going is not too difficult, when the workload is not too strenuous. We want to come to him on our terms rather than on his terms. I wonder if anybody else has that kind of issue, spiritually speaking. But what does Jesus say here to these would-be followers? We're going to look at that here in just a moment. But again, I want to tell you that we can learn to follow Jesus. And this is my goal for you today, that as we unpack this passage, that we will learn that we can follow Jesus and that we will want to. And I hope to give you some help to do that with an unflinching faith, no matter what that cost is. Why? Because he's already proven that he is worthy, and he has promised that it's going to all be worth it in the end. Let me ask you this. What's holding you back? Why would you put any reservations, any qualifications on your willingness to follow Jesus? What gets in your way? What is it that hinders you? What other priorities crowd out your devotion to Jesus? Well, Matthew goes to great lengths to show us that we can follow him because he is indeed the prophesied Messiah. Jesus is worth following because there is nobody else who has done what he has done. Nobody else who is who Jesus is. There is nobody like him. We have already, the past 2 weeks, been looking at what Jesus has done here in chapter 8 to bring cleansing to this leper. And just as a way of review, this leper had come as a great example for us to come to Jesus, no matter what we're going through, no matter what we've got going on, no matter what our past is or the baggage that we carry, we can approach Jesus just like that leper did. How? With faith that's bold, audacious, you might even say, with reverence, understanding that he is a sovereign God, with humility, but also with an expectation that when we come to him, we're going to get the healing and the help that we need. That's how the leper approached Jesus, and Jesus did not disappoint. The leper said, "Hey, if you are willing, you can make me clean." And what did Jesus say? "I am willing." And he touched him. You don't usually do that. You don't touch lepers, but he did. Showed him his love, showed him his compassion, and he showed him his healing power when he healed him. And then we saw last week the centurion who came to Jesus praying with a great desperation, not for himself, but on behalf of his servant who was at home lying paralyzed, suffering terribly. And likewise, he came to Jesus with a great faith, with reverence, and he understood the authority that Jesus had. He said, I'm not even worthy for you to come under my roof. All you've got to do is say the word, and my servant will be healed. And you remember how Jesus responded to that? He said, "Man, what great faith. I haven't found faith like that anywhere in Israel." And he healed his servant at that very moment. I'm telling you, we've got a God who is faithful, a God who is all-powerful, a God who has all authority in his hands. There is nothing that he cannot do. There is no situation that you are going through that is too hard for him, too difficult for him. You might be feeling like an outcast leper. You might be feeling like you're not worthy for Jesus to do anything for you, and maybe you're even afraid to come to him. But I'm telling you that those who come to him, who seek him with their whole heart, find him and find that he is good, find that he is faithful, find that he has all power and compassion and love available for you, and he is able to meet you where you are and to heal your heart. He is worth following because he is the prophesied Messiah. Here's what we see here in today's passage, that again, another instance of healing. He enters Peter's house, and Peter's mother-in-law is there lying sick with the fever. And what does Jesus do? He simply touches her. Again, he could have done it in 100 different ways, but here he showed her this kind of compassion and love by touching her hand, and tells us that the fever left her. That is the authority and the power that Jesus has with a word, with a touch, to bring healing. And what did she do? After the fever left, she rose and continued serving him and those, obviously, who were with him as well. And it doesn't stop there. That evening, they brought many to him who were oppressed by demons. Was that too difficult for Jesus to deal with? No, not at all. What about those who were sick with all kinds of sicknesses? Is that too difficult for Jesus to heal? Not a chance. He has authority over the demons, authority over every disease, every affliction, every sickness, and he is able to cast out the demons with the word. He is able to heal those who are sick. And then Matthew does something interesting for us in verse 17. He says, this is just a fulfillment of what Isaiah has already talked about. When Isaiah said that the Messiah who is to come will carry our afflictions, he will bear in his own body our sicknesses, our pains, our hurts, he was pointing forward to Christ, and this is now the one who has come and fulfilled that word. Jesus, and he alone, is the promised Messiah. He is worthy of our following. Now, Matthew in particular goes above and beyond in showing that Jesus is indeed this one who is to come. He is, he's already shown us this leper. He showed us a Gentile, the Roman centurion. He has shown us a woman. All of these are ones who, you know, were not always greatly respected and well-liked and beloved by the entire Jewish community, but there is something to be said for the way that Jesus doesn't put any discrimination against anybody. He is willing to heal all who will come to him, all who need his help. And I think that's important for us to remember, just because of whatever your background might be, whatever color of skin you have, whatever side of the tracks you're from, whatever language you speak, no matter what people label you as or what you've labeled yourself as, when you come to Jesus, he is so willing to meet you where you are and provide for you, because he loves you, and you need to know that today. So Matthew goes on to say, hey, you want proof that this Jesus is truly the Messiah? Well, let me give it for you. I mean, hopefully, you would be able to see these miracles that are taking place and recognize that nobody else does that. Who else can do that but God alone? But Matthew takes it farther and saying, and this is the same one who has fulfilled the prophecies that were made about him. And if we had, all afternoon, we could just do an entire Bible study through Matthew's gospel alone, showing how he is the one who has fulfilled these. And let me just give you a couple that you can reference and note if you want to, and then that might just be starter fodder for you. You can take it from there. But starting back at the very first chapter of Matthew, he is very careful to introduce Jesus as being, first of all, the son of David and the son of Abraham. That's pretty telling about how he's setting this entire gospel book up to show who Jesus is. Talks about his virgin birth, which was foretold by the prophet as well. You can see that in chapter 1, verses 22 and 23. Even the location of Jesus' birthplace, Bethlehem, that was foretold by the prophet Micah. You can see that in chapter 2, verse 5. And we could keep going. Chapter 2 has several notes that Matthew makes to say that this was done to fulfill what the Lord had already spoken out of the mouths of the prophets. Out of Egypt I called my son. Now you see Rachel's lament there in verse 18, spoken by the prophet Jeremiah. He was also called a Nazarene in chapter 2, verse 23. Even John the Baptist's ministry, John coming to prepare the way for the Lord, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, foretold in Isaiah chapter 40. Jesus' baptism, fitting to do what? Fulfill all righteousness, identifies who he is as well. He's the one who fulfilled the law and the prophets. Well, we can just keep going and going and going, and you can look at that as well. You get to the end of Matthew's gospel, and you see even in his death and his suffering and his crucifixion, some of the same types of languages, everything from his betrayal, that the scripture would be fulfilled in that. The falling away of the disciples, strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter. That's an Old Testament prophecy. The 30 pieces of silver, the price of a potter's field, referencing Old Testament prophecy as well. Even from the very cross upon which Jesus hangs, he quotes from Psalm chapter 22, saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why am I going through all of that, encouraging you to do your own homework on that? Again, it's just to say this is a Savior who is worth following. He is the one who has perfectly fulfilled everything that was spoken of him. The prophets, the law, the Psalms, everything in the Bible points to Jesus. He is worth giving your life entirely to. And if you have not done so yet, then there is no better time than now to say, Jesus, I'm yours. You have shown yourself. You have proven yourself. It's not just a blind faith. I'm not asking you to just follow him blindly. I'm asking you to look at who he is and to see with eyes of faith that he is worth giving your life to. And so that transitions then for us into what Matthew continues to say about the cost of following Jesus. So verse 18 says, when Jesus saw a crowd around him, he gave orders to go over to the other side. And that's an interesting note that I won't spend a lot of time on here this morning, but just leave it to say that Jesus was not a huge fan of big crowds. You know, he did not ever instruct his disciples to create a social media campaign where they would promote all of the works that he did. They didn't create TikTok videos highlighting all of his miracles or the healings or the feeding of the 5,000. I mean, that'd be pretty big today, right? Doing stuff like that, being all over Instagram and things of that nature. He wasn't looking just to find fickle fans. He was looking for those who would follow him faithfully. And so what we see then are two examples of those would-be followers that I think can give us some instruction today. So let me hit this first thought to say this. If you are serious about following Jesus, be ready for a road marked with hazards and not comforts. Can I get an amen from anybody in the crowd today?
Amen.
You know that to be true, don't you? Here's the first example. The scribe comes up to him. A scribe, by the way, was one of the teachers of the law. Often Jesus addresses scribes and Pharisees together. They had a pretty prominent position of interpreting the scripture and then putting that as teachers of the law before the people. Jesus often called them out for their hypocrisy, much like he did with the Pharisees. But this is a would-be follower who seems pretty eager. I mean, this, at the surface level, is a pretty bold declaration. Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go. But Jesus also knows the hearts of all men, doesn't he? And he responds in a way that lets this scribe know that the road is not just going to be an easy picnic in the park. If you're serious about following Jesus, you need to be ready to count the cost. And so he tells him, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. What's he saying? Saying, don't expect things to be easy. I'm traveling about, and even the animals that my Father has created, cares for them, provides them a place of rest, but I am not in a position where I'm going to guarantee you that we're going to stay overnight at the Crown Plaza every night. You know, you might have this idea that it's going to be this luxurious outing, and there's going to be some fame and fortune following along, but don't expect that. We're not going glamping. Anybody ever been glamping? You ever heard that term? Camping out in luxury. You know, it's not like that either. We're not chartering a bus to get from one town to the next. It's going to be a hard road. It's going to be filled with difficulty, and you've got to leave the things that you're familiar with and comfortable with that are easy and convenient at home. I love my bed. There's nothing like getting a good night's sleep in your own bed, right? But when you follow after Jesus, you might be prepared to unload that. You know, you might want to take that terry cloth monogrammed robe that you have that you love putting on in the morning, and those fuzzy slippers, and you know, the coffee maker in the morning. That, you know, how can you go without a cup of coffee in the morning, right? But Jesus says you got to be prepared to leave everything that you think is easy and comfortable and convenient behind. It is not a road of comfort. It is a road that is going to be marked with hazards. It is a narrow road. There will be difficulties along the way. You've got to be prepared for that. Are you prepared for it?
Amen.
Maybe that's the word we need to hear this morning. So if you're serious about following Jesus, be ready for a road that is marked with hazards and not just comforts. Try to get that. Hey, at least it was the Bible. All right, I'm going to give you a, boy, isn't it a quarter till 12 already? Oh, man. All right, I'm going to have to keep going. Never mind. All right, so the second thing. If you're serious about following Jesus, be ready for a road marked with hazards and not comforts. You know that. And then the second thing is, if you really want to go with Jesus, you better be willing to leave everything else behind. The second guy comes up and says, Lord, I'm willing to follow you, but you've got to first let me go and bury my father. And then Jesus says to him something that on the surface level might sound like, well, that's pretty rude, pretty insensitive. Follow me and leave the dead to bury their own dead. Man, that doesn't sound very Christ-like, does it? And if it was me saying that, or you saying that to somebody, that might not be a nice thing to say, but we can't accuse Jesus of saying anything that's not true. So what does that mean? Well, at the end of the day, it means this, that you better be willing to leave everything else behind. Even your family? Yeah. Even your family. You remember elsewhere Jesus has said, hey, don't think that I have come to bring peace to the world. I've not come to bring peace, but a sword. I've come to turn even family against each other. Brother betraying brother. Turning a daughter-in-law against your mother-in-law. Even within your family, you're going to have conflicts and division. You've got to be able to choose Christ even above your family. Let me tell you kind of briefly what this is saying. There's a couple of possibilities of what this might mean. But the most likely idea behind this is that this was an expression to say, let me bury my father. It didn't mean that his father had just died when he needed to attend the funeral and give him the proper burial. This was an expression that often would mean, let me stick around and until the point where my father dies and is buried, and then the inheritance is divided out. I need to take care of family responsibilities, which could be, you know, who knows how long, depending on whatever this guy's, maybe this guy's father could have lived another 10, 20, 30 years, whatever. He was saying that I've got to first attend to the family business, and I can't follow you until the time when my father dies, and then I get the inheritance, and then I'll have some freedom to go and follow after you. Jesus is saying, You can't choose that over me. You've got to be willing to abandon the things of this world that are temporal, even your family and even the family inheritance. You've got to choose Christ over that. We choose Christ over the earthly comforts. We've also got to choose Christ over the earthly commitments. He is worth it. That's why we started with that. He is worth following. And so we've got to be ready to make those decisions, because he is not looking for those who are half-hearted, who are halfway committed, or who have put other priorities on the plate to say, okay, I'm with you, Jesus, but I can't be there until about 9:30 or 10, and I've got a show that I watch at 4:30 in the afternoon, and I'm really not, into that, roughing it thing. I kind of like my running water, and I like that hot shower in the morning, and I like air conditioning, and I like sleeping on my pillow top comforter mattress, and so if it's going to be, a difficult thing, then I'm not really sure I can be all in. I'm with you in name, I'm with you in spirit, but that's as far as I can go. And you know what? He might just turn you away if you are not fully committed. You remember a few weeks ago when we were preaching, we said we need to have an undivided allegiance to Jesus. It is that same moment. We need to declare that we are his, and we are his fully, and we are his wholly, that he is our absolute top priority, and that there are no other earthly commitments, no other earthly attachments that can compare with a wholehearted, wholly true decision to follow after Christ. We've got to be all in, undivided in our allegiance to him. What about you today? The interesting thing in this passage is it does not tell us whether these would-be disciples made a commitment to follow after Jesus or were turned away and decided that they didn't really think they could do it after all. I think by implication that we don't see them in any way. Jesus doesn't commend them for a fate that chooses him over the other things. We could probably say that it's implied that they went away, maybe like that rich young ruler, went away sorrowful that day. But the question is more about us. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? We're going to choose to follow Jesus even when the going gets tough. We're going to choose to stand for Christ even when it means that your family doesn't agree with what you do. Maybe some of you are here today and you've got a husband or a wife or children at home who would much rather you have spent the time with them and say, I don't understand why you go to that church every Sunday morning. I don't see why you're so committed to Jesus when we've got all this stuff happening here at home that you need to be attending to. I'd rather you be here with me. And you know it's not easy because you are making that choice to be here, to follow Jesus, to live out his way, his truth, instead of the ease and the comfort and just for the sake of getting along, it might be a lot simpler if you didn't. So what is Jesus asking you to do? Are there some things that you know you need to leave behind in order to choose him? Let me give you one final thought here. It is this: those who follow Jesus with unflinching faith find that he is truly worth it all, both now and forever. Now and forever, he is worth it because he's promised. What is he promised? What's he promised now? What are the blessings right now of following after Jesus? Well, you probably know some of them yourself, but let me just give you a couple of things. It is the joy of knowing him. You will not experience the kind of joy in life until you choose Jesus above everything else. There are temporary pleasures that you can enjoy for just a little while, but they will not fill you with the kind of joy that goes beyond every circumstance and every situation and every high and every thing that you can do. The joy that you have in Jesus makes it worth it right now. You can have a peace in Christ that passes all understanding. When you choose him above everything else, you will experience the peace of knowing that he is guarding your heart and your mind day by day. And you can live with that. And you can experience it in a way that you cannot experience it anywhere else. But in Christ, you can have it. You can have the blessing of just knowing that he is with you, that he is your comforter, and he is your counselor, the filling of his Holy Spirit and his presence with you day by day, the fellowship of walking with the Lord. And you can have a hope that is unshakable despite the hardships that you're going through and that you will go through in this life. Even right now, he has promised these blessings to you. And they are all yours. But you've got to choose Jesus above everything else. And of course, we know that the blessings that are still yet to come are even greater than what we can experience in this life. The eternal home that we have in heaven. One day there will be a new heaven and a new earth in which righteousness dwells, where there will be no more tears, no more sorrow, no more suffering, no more pain anymore. The old things will be gone. Behold, the new has come in fullness. And that is what we have to look forward to. That is what we anticipate now. But one day it will be a reality for those who do what? Who choose Christ above the things of this world. It's not just automatic. Not everybody gets to go to heaven. I hate to break that to you, but only those who experience the joy of heaven are those who humble themselves in repentance and in faith, confess Jesus as Lord and Savior of their lives. So what about you today? Do you have that assurance? And when your time is up, or when Jesus comes again, that you will be with him, and you will experience the promises of that heavenly reward, you can have that today. And if you don't already, I would plead with you to turn to Jesus, look to him. See, we know something that these would-be disciples did not yet know. We know that Jesus, who lived a perfect and sinless life, came to the place where he suffered and bled and died for us on the cross. He paid the penalty for our sin. See, the Bible tells us that all have sinned and all fall short of the glory of God. There is nobody who can earn favor with God by doing righteous deeds. You might be a good person. I'm not saying you're not a good employee at work. I'm not saying that you're not a good neighbor. I'm not saying that you're not a good dad or a good grandma or a good citizen. But none of those things will earn salvation. You cannot add up all of your good deeds and try to create a ladder to get to heaven based on the things that you have done. You just cannot do it. There is none righteous, not even one. And God's standard is perfection, holiness, to which none of us will ever attain. We have all sinned. We have all fallen short of the glory of God. And what's even worse than that is that the Bible says the wages of sin is death. That's what we really deserve because of our sin against God. We don't deserve his mercy. We don't deserve his grace. We don't deserve his favor. We deserve separation and eternal punishment in hell. But the good news of the gospel is that Jesus Christ loves you so much that he willingly went to the cross. And on the cross, he bore all of our sin in his body. He took our place, and he became our substitute. And so when he shed his blood, it was for the forgiveness of our sins, and it was for our cleansing and for our righteousness, so that when we put our faith and trust in him, we are not only are forgiven for all of our sin, but we are made new, made right. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. And it can be yours today, by his grace. By his grace through faith. Our response is to believe. It is coming with empty hands, as the leper, as the centurion, saying, I have nothing to offer, but I am pleading to you for something more important than physical healing. I need spiritual healing. I need your forgiveness. I need your cleansing. I need to be made right with you, O God. And do you know what? He is so willing, so eager to forgive you for your sins. No matter where you've been, what you've done, he is willing to forgive it all. and to cleanse you and to make you new. Whoever believeth in him should not perish. You don't have to experience death and hell and separation from God. But you can have new life. Everlasting life through Christ Jesus our Lord. Will you come to him today? Father, we thank you today for your love for us. We thank you for the gospel message that brings salvation to those who believe. And God, today I pray that if there's even one hearing this word who has not yet come to faith and trust in Jesus, that now, at this very moment, your Spirit would show them the glory of what it means to be saved, to trust in you alone for salvation. And friend, let me say this. If that's you today, you know that God is knocking on the door of your heart. Maybe you feel it. Maybe you've got those goosebumps or something going on in your spirit that you cannot explain. I'm telling you, that is the Spirit of God saying, this is the way. Why not just give your heart and life to him fully today? Maybe even expressing it in words like this. Jesus, I know I need you. I know I'm a sinner and I cannot save myself. But I believe that you died in my place on the cross. And I believe you rose in victory from the grave. And so I am giving my life to you. I'm turning away from my sin, and I'm trusting in you for salvation today. Thank you for this new, abundant, and eternal life. Now help me to be a true disciple, to live wholly for you. God, I thank you for the work that you're doing in the hearts and lives of the people here today. Let all of us be faithful to follow you no matter what the cost. Oh God, we're living in the midst of a broken, hurting, and dying world that needs to see what faithfulness to Christ looks like. You have raised up your church for that very purpose, to be the city on a hill that cannot be hidden, shining your light into the darkness, to help us to be faithful, to live for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Would you stand as we sing our invitation song today? And I pray that as you sing this, this will not just be words that you're mouthing, but it'll be a true heartfelt response to what this message of commitment to Jesus is truly all about. Let's sing it.
Allegiance, let our day.
Thank you again for your time and attention today, and trust you'll take this message and be fully committed to Christ as we go forth from here. Any further word before we dismiss today? All right. So youth meeting here with parents right away if possible, and if you're able to go to that picnic tonight at Western Oaks, we'd love to see you there, and I'll be happy to give you a ride. Be here at 4:30. All right. You're dismissed. God bless you.